I would like to introduce our next presenter, Ramon Gregorio. So let me tell you a little bit about Ramon. Ramon Gregorio is the founder and manager of Lucent Research Limited. It's a leading market research agency that provides evidence-based solutions to a wide array of profits and not-for-profit agencies across 16 countries, would you believe, throughout the Caribbean, Latin America, and Africa. Ramon has an undergraduate degree in accounting from the University of the West Indies, St. Augustine, and a postgraduate degree in marketing from the London Metropolitan University, United Kingdom. He's a member of many professional research associations, and he's a former lecturer at the University of the West Indies. However, as he puts it, his most important role to date is that of being a husband and a father. When he's not searching for marketing insights for a client or spending time with his family unit, Ramon can be found with a bat and ball playing his favorite sport, cricket, just like in his childhood days in Curup. So ladies and gentlemen, at this juncture, I'd like to introduce Ramon Gregorio, our next panelist.
Good night, ladies and gentlemen, and members of the panel, members of the member associations, and members of the viewing public, both on Facebook as well as on this forum. So thank you very much for having me here tonight and giving me the opportunity to share some sentiments about the new normal COVID-19, and from a market research perspective, what are some of the things to expect. Now, could everybody see my screen here? Right. So first and foremost, we can't start these proceedings without ensuring and hoping, sending best wishes to you and your family members. It is indeed a very difficult time, a time, as Jolene had mentioned in her conversation, like no other time in our history that we have experienced. So I want to start by hoping that you and your families are well and safe tonight and have staved off the vagaries of COVID-19. So I want to start with a quote. A crisis stimulates a change in beliefs, needs, attitudes, both during and after the events. This means that consumers' perception of the value of certain products and services may also change. And that's from my colleague, Dirk Huseman, from the Green Book newsletter, market research newsletter. So in the past few weeks, we have changed our mindsets. And our mindsets have moved from doubles gate last week, where we had a massive outcry at St. Christopher's about package doubles versus the traditional doubles, the greasy doubles paper. But what it has done is has opened us up to a different type of conversation. It has opened us up to discuss what are some of the new channels out there that as a business owner and as somebody who's navigating some of these challenges, what are some of the opportunities that we have out there based on these new channels and developments? So it really calls for business resilience. And when we say business resilience, what we're talking about is understanding new ways of work. So Jolene quite succinctly put that into context in terms of how we go back out to work, how we coexist in a new environment. It also speaks about integrating digital with face-to-face interaction. More importantly, it talks about gathering intelligence. So for the first time, what we have to consider is that what we knew before March 2020, we almost have to assume does not exist anymore. And I'll talk a bit about that a bit later. So we have to now create this new normal, and our businesses have to be resilient to be able to operate in this new normal with new information, with new insights, and with a new perspective. So a key to that is really constant communications with your stakeholders, direct communication, phone, picking up the phone and making calls, having face-to-face conversations, of course, 6 feet apart, but more importantly, being able to connect in a different way than how we traditionally would have connected. Now, at Lucent, we conducted a mood and sentiment survey over the past few weeks, and we just had some preliminary findings to share with you this evening at our session. So we asked the question, how much do you agree with each of the following statements about COVID-19 in terms of spending and purchasing habits? And what we are seeing is that I'm reducing daily spend to save more. 71% of us share that sentiment. I plan to spend less on luxury items, 86%. I'm using online shopping to purchase products I would normally buy in store, 49%, with some level of indifference, strongly disagreeing and indifference. And uncertainty about the economy is preventing me from making purchases or investments. I'm sure we could all relate to some of these sentiments that we are seeing here. Now, this was a large sample that we collected 960 members of the public via our online platform. and it is quite recent. So the data here really speaks to, it really lends a different type of conversation. It really gives us perspective in terms of what to expect in the next few weeks. Some of the restrictions have been eased, but at the same time, persons are going out there a bit tentatively, a bit circumspect, not knowing exactly what to expect in this new environment. 4 in 10 consumers believe that their households will be negatively impacted by COVID-19 in the next 3 to 6 months. What we'll be doing is a series of these sentiment assessments over the next few months, where we'll be tracking and looking at behavior as it changes and as persons become more comfortable, as persons orient themselves into this new normal. Consumers generally expect to decrease spending across categories in the next 3 to 6 months. So hold on, for the persons who enter carnival and who enter fetting and partying, 82% of the persons who we surveyed had indicated that they will no longer liming, fetting and partying. In that, they'll be decreasing spending on those activities. In terms of cars and automobiles, it's generally about the same, 44% being the dominant statistic for that particular category. In terms of electronics and appliances, yet again, decreased spending. In terms of fast food, restaurant, pickup delivery, 79%, albeit this was captured just on the verge of the Prime Minister making a mention of the relaxing of some of the restrictions. So it'll be interesting to see what the statistic looks like in a month's time. But 79% of persons said they're going to be decreasing spending on fast food, restaurant, pickup, and delivery. I trust now everybody's a connoisseur and an expert doubles, fried chicken, and roti maker. So that is not a startling statistic at this point, but as it unwinds and as the new normal becomes the normal, we'll see how the statistic changes. And as it relates to alcoholic beverages, we see 64% of persons indicating that they'll be decreasing spending. So, do we expect the return to normal spending? Consumers generally do not expect that. They do not expect their spending to return to normal anytime soon. Roughly 4 in 10 suggest that their spending will never be normal again. So if we combine within a year and would be never normal again, that's almost 70% of the sample given a share in that sentiment, which is something that policymakers, which is something that members of the various chambers and associations would have to take into consideration as persons adjust to this new environment. In terms of social media usage, the majority of us are at home, the majority of us are in front of devices. Roughly 2/3 of Facebook and WhatsApp users suggest that their usage of these platforms has increased. So we are seeing more social media usage, and as it has, and mind you, the sample, the population for this particular exercise would have been 18 plus years. So it'll be interesting among some of the younger demographics, for example, what the Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, and TikTok would be. In upcoming segments, we'll be looking at some of those areas and tracking their behaviors also. Which are the platforms that traditionally lend themselves to a younger demographic. So Facebook, WhatsApp, and Twitter, we're seeing increased usage of Facebook and WhatsApp, 65% each, with Instagram falling up quite at some distance, albeit some distance, 29%. So what do we need to do to stay focused? And that's been a burning question across the minds of a lot of consumers, across the minds of a lot of business owners. How do we stay focused in this environment? We have to continue to collect data. Collecting data is a continuous data collection process, is the order of the day. We have to continue touching, meeting our consumers at their various touch points, contacting them, being in constant, and having a constant understanding of changes, adjustments. We have seen with the COVID-19, we go back to our doubles examples. Persons had restricted access to a particular delicacy, they became chefs, they became doubles connoisseurs, they created their own product. So we have to look for those vagaries, we have to look for those shifts in the environment, because it's an evolving environment and people are spending less, people are fraternizing less, people are, and the numbers are showing that people are not going to be as normal as we saw in terms of how they spend. So we have to always be listening. We have to be continuously assessing change to be able to effectively react quickly as businesses. And then understanding sentiment. There's a lot of fear in the air. There's a lot of, Jolene mentioned it in her presentation a bit earlier, there's a lot of challenges. People are not confident to go out there unless they are infected by someone who doesn't practice the necessary procedures. So assessing consumer sentiment is very important, not just how they consume, but how do they feel? How do my employees feel? How do my colleagues feel? It's a mental adjustment that we have to make in this environment, and it can't be swept under the rug and not given the level of credence that it requires. Mental health during this particular time is it's one of the conversations that you're hearing less about in favor of the economy, in favor of spending patterns, in favor of job loss, which are all equally essential and important measures. But mental health, how are consumers feeling? Not necessarily about our brands, but their ability to spend, their ability to go out and traverse this whole new world. And then message testing. One of the things organizations should look into is, what are the messages are we putting out there? And we have to be very careful about being tone deaf in this current environment. It can be business as usual and sell, sell, sell. We have to understand the challenges that COVID-19 creates. We have to tailor our messages in a very meaningful, tangible manner so that persons understand the sentiment, people understand that we are a caring organization before the dollars and cents. And sometimes, if you look at some of the messages across the media over the past few weeks, sometimes it's a bit tone deaf, in my opinion, simply because persons didn't take the time. The fear factor has come in, and persons didn't take the time to address persons' fears and concerns and positive messaging that could help. There is some, and there are some institutions that have put up their hands and really came to the fore, but there are some that you really need to watch the effectiveness and the fit for the type of messaging and the type of environment that we want to create. And then tracking our brands. As I mentioned earlier in our conversation, what we knew before March 2020 does not necessarily exist. So for example, persons who weren't on social media as frequently are now on social media. There are tons of demographics now and subsets of demographics that are displaying different types of behavior that we have to track and we have to assess for our brand. If our brand is to grow, we have to understand how it's going to grow as we look at the different demographic ages. So for example, you have the iGens and the Gen Zs on particular social media platforms, but hey, hold on, auntie and granny, the boomers and the silents, they're on social media also now too. And they're very much versed in Zoom and video conferencing technology, talking to cousins in the States, talking to my friend in Brooklyn, talking to an aunt in London. So what has happened now is that someone who potentially wasn't your consumer before may very well fall into your category now and be amenable to your products and services. So we have to constantly track our brands to look for change. We have to constantly track our brands to understand where those potential gaps and opportunities are, because it is not business as usual, it's a new normal. So the rules that we played by pre-March 2020 does not necessarily exist in May 2020 and beyond. So we need to understand usage and attitudes. How are people using our brands? How are people integrating? So for example, persons, and I keep going back to that Doubles example because it's such a real example. Of course, until KFC Gate comes up next, well, KFC Gate was this week. We'll see what gate we have next week. But what you really have to look at is, how are people using the variant brands now? And are they making subtle adjustments? Are they making changes in terms of how they use it? And then their digital habits. How are they interacting with brands? Are they touch? Obviously, we don't have face-to-face contact. What are some of the digital habits that we are seeing in the community? And digital habits, of course, how they interact across the digital platforms to share and receive information. So the world has changed. And a lot of clients have come to us, a lot of persons have approached us asking, Ramon, how do I plan? What we are saying is you have to focus on short and medium term tactical planning at this stage while keeping your eye on your long-term goals, simply because the vagaries of COVID-19, such a fluid pandemic, such a fluid environment that you have to continuously adjust your planning and literally go from day to day. Obviously with a longer term plan, with a longer term strategy on the horizon, appreciating that could also change in a short space of time also. So what are some of the tools that you as an entrepreneur, what are some of the tools that you as a business owner could utilize? And these are some options in the market research world that I'll share with you tonight. You can look at online and mobile, qualitative and quantitative. Obviously, qualitative is from the heart, words, quantitative being numbers. So there are a number of online and mobile applications that are bandying about now. You see them across social media. You see them, you have access to them. You interact with them on a regular basis. But those are options in terms of how you capture data. Of course, you can do online focus groups and interviews. Obviously, yet again, face-to-face contact is not out of the day these days. So that we look at the online focus groups and interviews as a valid option to be able to extract data from your variant segments to understand behavior change. Some of the things that we've been talking about in the past few minutes. Lucent, we have undertaken an exercise just recently where we looked at the different generational cohorts and in terms of their response to COVID. You can do a similar approach. Feel free to go to our YouTube page, look at Lucent Research, and get a sense of how it could be done or it could be administered. Obviously, you may not be a research professional and would execute it in the same exact way, but it gives you a starting point in terms of how you could engage. It gives you a starting point in terms of how you could communicate with your stakeholders, and gives you a starting point in terms of what are some of the things I need to be discussing now with my consumers? What are some of the things I need to be discussing for the next 3 to 6 months? So those are the things that one needs to stay, to keep their finger on the pulse with. Of course, we can do omnibus surveys, mobile trade audits. Some persons operate supermarkets, some persons operate trade establishments where you need to see interaction with brands, and some of the big brands will be looking towards you to give them that type of information. What's moving from the shelves? What's not moving? Obviously, in a pandemic environment, what's going to happen is persons may substitute brands that they traditionally did not consume before. So I may have been, for example, into organic products, and now I'm going back to my traditional products that perhaps potentially are not as healthy. But it may be a subset of my budget. It may be a subset of my reduced spending. It may be a subset of my income levels being depreciated. Obviously, job loss being a factor. So we have to constantly watch the trade and understand. And this is for persons who this impacts their daily livelihood to understand. So mobile trade audits, go around, check and see what's moving, have those conversations. It really calls for rolling up your sleeves. It really calls for going out into the field. It really calls for having more conversations. And then your web usability, your social media. Those are some of your biggest drivers of activity in this environment. How equipped am I? How easy is my website to use? How easy is it to navigate and find the information I need to find about your brand that help you make a decision as to whether I patronize your business or not? What about my social media pages? Am I utilizing them? Am I maximizing them? The next speaker, Douglas, will speak a lot more about social media and some of the implications. However, what is some of the information and data that I'm getting from these specific areas that will help me make those decisions yet again? So am I using online methodologies? Am I doing my online surveys with SurveyMonkey? Am I picking up the telephone and just connecting and asking the questions that I need to ask? Am I going back to the persons who are the influencers in my space? Am I going back to the persons who are the big customers who will give me some of the feedback, but also listening to the small and medium-sized customer also? So it's really about reconnecting. And that's the simple message that I want to share tonight about reconnecting and deep listening to our environment. So what are 3 quick takeaways before we wrap the conversation? And essentially, it's really simple. It's looking for free data. There are loads of different environments now. There are a lot of environments where you can get access to free data, lots of white papers, a lot of industry reports from the variant chambers, from other research establishments. We are one big research fraternity. Please use some of the data that is exposed there. Lucent's very own mood and sentiment survey will be up, will be in circulation by next week when we publish some of the data. So feel free, access any free data that you can get your hands on that could assist in helping you make some decisions. More importantly, continue to listen to your consumers and clients and stakeholders, both formally and informally. So it could be any form of a survey, but informally, as I've mentioned, about picking up the phone, sending an email, sending a tweet, posting an image, but more importantly, listen to feedback. Feedback is very, very critical as we navigate these waters. And then use every opportunity to collect data at every touch point. So Your cashiers, for example, they should be engaging clients to get the information. When persons buy, you have persons who buy big, small, in between. They should also be, you should also have access to those persons so that you're able to connect. You're able to hear. You scour the social media pages. You scour email complaints and you look at your complaints and if you have more developed systems and CRM systems, responding to complaints effectively, but more importantly, we have to react and we have to be very proactive and not reactive in this particular environment. I would like to end by saying it is not business as usual. It is a new normal, but we can navigate this new normal armed with the tools of data, armed with the tools of intelligence, and armed with the tools of deep listening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ramon, for providing us with such a length and breadth of information, as it were. I just want to emphasize what it is he said. This crisis has proven that we really do have to find new ways to work, new ways to do old things, with an emphasis on gathering the intelligence, of course. And as Ramon would have alluded to, that means there are implications to gathering that data, analyzing that data. And of course, listening to those changes, those subtle changes sometimes that would occur in the micro and macro environment of your business. So once again, I would remind people, if you have any questions, you can feel free to post them on the chat facility. I am seeing one or two questions. In fact, I'm seeing one, but I think this policy would be more for Dr. Charles. So seeing as she's already spoken, this is a question from Trishana Rajnath, who wants to know what are your thoughts on employees mandating in their company policy that employees are required to wear masks? And so I think that's a question more suited for Dr. Charles. So what I would do is I would put that question out again for Dr. Charles at the end of the presentation of the third and final panelist. But I'm scouring here, looking to see if I can find any questions on the chat for Ramon himself. I'm not seeing any. And hello?
Yeah, I saw one question.
Sure.
Asking about the socioeconomic group. Yeah, the socioeconomic group would have, it is asking what socioeconomic group was surveyed. We surveyed middle to middle income individuals. So from a research perspective, the socioeconomic levels B, C, and D. Obviously, to a lesser extent, A, and to a lesser extent, E. So it was really a middle class survey that really got the sense from in this particular version. What we will be doing is tracking over a wider cross-section of socioeconomic groups over the next few months.
Thank you, Ramon. I'm not seeing any more questions that will be directed to you. There are some compliments, however, good presentation and so on. Seeing one here. Ramon, I'm glad you mentioned CRM systems. I'm not sure that many SMEs invest in them and they can be so beneficial. Thanks for a fabulous presentation. That's pretty much it. All right, Ramon, someone is asking Ramon, what are omnibus surveys?
Yeah, omnibus surveys, this is Rebecca, essentially are surveys where, essentially they get a little bit of everything in that survey. So what happens is that you ask a range of different questions, but it may span a range of different industries, each industry having two or three particular questions from that particular category. So it's a very cost-effective way of conducting research where everybody gets a bit of information in and gets some data from it, as opposed to a commissioned research from one sole entity. So everybody gets a share of the number of questions that could be asked in that particular survey based on their needs and requirements.
All right. Thank you very much, Ramon. So once again, I want to remind people, somebody's asking something. Hello? Oh, okay. Right. So once again, I want to remind everybody, participants, that you can ask your questions at the end of the third panelist's discussion. But even while the third panelist is discussing and you feel there's a burning question that you'd like to ask, feel free to do so. And with that in mind, of course, I'm going to introduce the third panelist or final panelist for the night, Douglas Ames. Let me tell you a little bit about Mr. Ames. Douglas Ames has been an entrepreneur for most of his life, from washing cars, as he describes it, and mowing lawns as a schoolboy in Maraval to operating his school's popcorn machine, would you believe? And in 1996, a year after leaving his alma mater, St. Anthony's College, he started Ames Information Services, a telecommunications company which presented Net2 phones, the leading VoIP service provider at the time. Now, Douglas soon ventured into the burgeoning internet industry. He owned Homeview Caribbean, a company designed to stream live radio and television content to the West Indian diaspora on a pay-per-view and subscription basis. And in May 2006, he sold Homeview to a publicly traded company in Dubai known as Jump TV. I'm sure some of you would know it. And for 3 years, Douglas served as Jump TV's general manager for Africa and the Caribbean. Returning to Trinidad in 2009, Douglas launched his latest venture, Toucan, with offices in Dubai, Jamaica, Kenya, and an affiliate office in Trinidad. Toucan makes digital simple for businesses in emerging markets by executing strategy to harness the power of digital media to increase sales, improve operational efficiency, and achieve other business objectives. Ladies and gentlemen, at this juncture, I would like to introduce you to panelist number 3, Mr. Douglas Ames. Douglas Ames? All right, well, maybe by the time we take on. He's here. Okay.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, yes, Douglas.
Are you hearing me now?
Yes, we are, yes.
Okay, there great. Sorry about that.
Slight delay, but we're hearing you.
Okay, great. I was saying thank you very much for having me here this evening. I am very humbled and honored. I had a question for Ramon for after the session, Ramon. You have a stat here, 82% of trainees will fet less, lime less, and party less in the next 3 to 6 months. I have to see that to believe it.
Yes, I'm based on the recent reports where guys were picked up by the beach and picked up recently. That's a statistic that we really have to track and monitor over the next few months and see how it stands.
Okay, cool. All right, excellent. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen, everybody.
Okay.
So here we go. The presentation, as you can see, is entitled Adapting Your Business to the New Normal. One of the questions we've been asked a lot over the last 6 to 8 weeks is how to ensure business continuity. It's one of the major questions we get asked every day, using the power of digital media. And some of the questions I get every day on the phone, via email, via social media, through our web forms is, how do businesses continue to get paid by their clients? How do they and their staff are able to work remotely? How do you process paperwork? How do we maintain sales? And how do we deliver to those customers? So these are the 5 burning topics or inquiries that we get every day, and people try to apply a digital solution to them. A lot of the inquiries we've gotten are from businesses that don't have a fully e-commerce online presence at this time. They might be restricted to just social media, having a Facebook fan page or an Instagram account. Or if they do have a website or an app, it's not truly e-commerce ready. It is what we like to call a brochure website, whereby you can just inquire about the company's products and services, but you can't actually pull out your credit card and transact business online. So we've been asked to try and facilitate going online as quickly as possible. And some of the ways to do that and possible solutions to solve these 5 main problems, create an e-commerce website and complement it with a social media presence. For those of you that have websites and apps already established, you'll be quite surprised. You can get e-commerce up and running in anywhere between 3 to 5 days using PayPal, WePay, and some other options that are available on the internet. You can also integrate WhatsApp for your business. A lot of customers are on WhatsApp and they want to place orders. So for those of you who may not have the money to do an e-commerce website now, or may not be prepared to do so because you're out in too many fires, integrating WhatsApp for business is a great solution to be able to transact business with your customers. Switching to an online accounting system like QuickBooks, one of the number one questions we get asked is, how can I automate everything in my business right now, Douglas? I'm accustomed to sending out my bills for services via the post. I'm accustomed to clients coming in and paying us with a check or cash based on the invoices we send them. How can I put that online? Switching to an online accounting system, or even a temporary system that allows you to create PDFs and send out your invoices or bills via email, is a great way to get invoices into customers' hands for your products and services. In terms of getting staff to work from home, creating a virtual private network. You can quite easily make all of your files that you have in the company available to your staff. For those of you that have IT managers or IT department, you can get them to create a virtual private network where they can safely and securely transfer files between their home computers and the office servers. For the smaller businesses that are on the call, you don't have the VPN. You can actually use free tools like Google Drive, or you can pay for the subscription. It's very affordable, $99 a year. And you can get a subscription to Google Drive, as well as opendrive.com and other platforms that are out there that allow you to have a cloud network. Review your offers with the aim of adding value. To Ramon's point, a lot of people are very scared and conscious about what's happening in the economy, and therefore they're very hesitant to spend, and therefore you need to show value for money, and you need to justify to a customer why I should spend now, given everything that's happening. So messaging is very important. Reviewing your offers with the aim of adding value, so customers say, okay, this makes sense to me to invest in this now. And managing customers' expectations with digital media messages. We have a lot of existing clients, as well as prospective clients that call us every day, that say they are having difficulty meeting their expectations because the government restrictions don't permit them to open their business. So customers can't physically come in. Until recently, a lot of the food delivery, a lot of the food businesses were shut down. I see they're now allowed to deliver. But there are a lot of retailers out there who are having challenges in meeting customers' expectations because their stores are closed, and they're trying to find ways of perhaps allowing people to order the product online. And then when further restrictions are lifted, they'll deliver to the home. So those are the kind of solutions that you can apply to some of these issues that everyone experiences, which is how to get paid, how to work remotely, how to process paperwork, how to deliver, and how to maintain sales. Now, a lot of the questions we get asked a lot is, Douglas, how do we go about setting up an e-commerce website or an app? Is it something I can do in 3 days? Is it something I can do in 6 weeks? It really depends on the nature of your business. If you're a small business like a restaurant, and you want to be able to get online to receive food delivery orders, you can get a decent website or mobile app created in 4 to 5 business days that will allow you to have your menu online, to be able to for customers to sign up for your app and be able to order and pay either cash on delivery or online for their food order. But as I said, it really depends on the nature of your business. A lot of the questions we also get is, how much does it cost? Well, each web service company or mobile app developer has different costs. But usually for a small to medium-sized business, I'll use a retailer as an example, a fully e-commerce website can cost anywhere between 25,000 TT to 35,000 or 40,000 TT, again, depending on the intended form and functionality. And there are websites out there like airline websites that can cost millions of dollars. It really depends on the nature of your business. But on average, for a small it's a medium-sized business, you will find most developers out there will charge between 25 and 40,000 TT for a website. Now, this is where the banks or other service providers come in. There are a number of options to be able to receive payments online. And when I say payments online, I mean Visa, MasterCard, and most recently, WePay vouchers. So typically, the vendors that are mentioned below, Scotiabank, RBC, PayPal, First Citizens, Republic, WePay, Caribbean, they all offer what is known as an e-merchant account, which is basically a virtual credit card machine. So the same way you go into a pharmacy or you go into a grocery store and you pull out your credit card and there's a point of sale terminal that you enter your PIN and the transaction is authorized. That's what an e-merchant account basically is, but everything is virtual via your website or app. And they typically charge between 2 to 5% of the total value of every transaction. There's also a charge of between 25 to 50 cents US on each transaction. The variance, quite frankly, depends on how many transactions you do monthly. So if you're a big retailer or a big business and you do thousands of transactions a day or a month, you can negotiate a much better rate. Most of the service providers charge a setup fee. It does vary according to who you go with, but on average, we found it costs about US $250 as a one-time setup fee. There is an application process, and no offense to the bankers on the call, but they want to know everything, including who your grandmother is. But usually, if you're an existing customer, it's much easier. And usually, with the banks, the processing time is about 4 to 6 weeks. With PayPal, it is a matter of minutes. You can actually sign up for PayPal and be up and running in half an hour or less. And WePay takes about 5 to 10 working days, whereas the commercial banks can take between 4 to 6 weeks. So at least this has been our experience. The reason why the banks take so long is because when you apply for an e-merchant account, they actually also consider it a credit facility. And therefore, they have a lot of checks and balances. For some of the banks that are foreign owned, the applications actually have to be sent to a head office abroad to get approval, which can take a week or two. And then, of course, they want to ensure your website or app is secure. So they have a lot of security requirements, ensuring you have a SSL certificate, ensuring that all of the information during the transaction is encrypted, PCI compliance, and a lot of other things. PayPal, if you're a very small business, might be your best option. And the way PayPal works is it treats your credit card as a deposit account. So what happens is that the same way you use your credit card to buy things, you can actually use your credit card to receive money. Many people don't know that. So when you sign up with PayPal and you tell PayPal you want to receive money, when people pay you, you can actually withdraw the money from PayPal and tell PayPal you want to deposit it on your credit card. Then you go into your bankers or any bank that accepts Visa, MasterCard, and you can actually tell them you'd like to make a withdrawal from your credit card. And the bank will take a commission for doing that. I believe when last I checked, it was about 2 to 3% commission for withdrawing funds from your credit card once it's in credit. And PayPal take a commission of between 1.5 to 3%. All right. Ramon had shared some stats with you. As we know, mobile is king. More than 85% of users worldwide use their mobile phone to access the internet. And more than 69% of Trinidadians use their mobile phone every day to access the internet. As of today, these are the top 10 apps downloaded from the Google Play and App Stores. So Zoom is number one, TikTok, Bip, which is a new messaging app, WhatsApp, Facebook, Instagram, Ludo Club, which is a game, My Digicel, which is the app that allows you to top up, check your bill, etc., Snapchat, and another game called Garena. Now, these stats are available online. I'll share in the chat with you the resources that you can use online to access this. It's updated on a daily basis. And it's interesting to note that TikTok 2 months ago was number 8 in Trinidad and Tobago. And within the last 6 to 8 weeks, TikTok is now the de facto number one social media network in Trinidad and Tobago. It has overtook Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and even WhatsApp in terms of its usage. And as for you, those of you who don't know TikTok, it is a video social networking site that allows you to have videos between 10 to 15 seconds long. So that's basically my presentation this evening. I'm open to any questions that you may have after, and thank you again for having me.
Thank you very much, Douglas. A lot of food for thought, of course. You know, developing your an e-commerce profile is not just possible, but absolutely necessary. Integrating the platforms that you use, such as WhatsApp and so on, and so many other things. I think one of the other things coming out of it is, you know, everything in between, from developing apps to setting up appropriate payment systems. Lots of food for thought. So, as you said, I think at this juncture, I'm going to open up the floor. If anybody has any question that they'd like to ask, I'm also putting Dr. Julian Charles and Ramon Gregorio on standby as well. So if anybody would like to ask any questions of any of our three panelists, feel free to do so now orally. I will also be scanning the chats to see if there are any questions coming in as well. So feel free. So the floor is now open, just that you know.
There was a question posed to me, re the mask, mm-hmm. wearing and the donning and the doffing of the mask. In terms of
would you mask, like me to read it over, or you want to read?
You
want to read over the question?
You can read it over for the interest of other persons.
Yeah, so they know, yeah. So the question was posed by one Trishana Rajna. She says, she asked, what are your thoughts on employers mandating in their company policy that employees are required to wear masks when moving from one department to another?
Right. So my thoughts on that are, masks should only be changed when they are damp, or when you have felt like there has been some kind of direct contact with somebody who you believe to have been, who has been exposed, or somebody who directly droplet infection, like they cough on you, etc. Then you should doff it, as in take it off correctly, touching the back of the mask, not the front. And then you sanitize your hands by washing, and then you put on a new one. But it is not, I'm not sure what company is proposing that. I don't want to go against their rules, but it is not international recommendation that it be changed on entering a new room. I hope that answers the question.
All right. Okay. While we waiting on that, chat, they see that the session has been recorded, so they're wondering if they can get a copy, because there's a lot of good information being disseminated here. So maybe you can throw some light on that, Maria.
Of course, we will email the recordings to all the participants after the session. Either between Friday to Monday, but for the latest on Monday. In addition to the PowerPoints as well.
Okay, good, cool. Dr. Charles, Julian Charles, there's another question here from Vishnu Balroop. He's asking, do you recommend that masks be worn by all persons entering an establishment?
Yes, I definitely recommend masks should be worn by all persons.
Julian, Dr. Charles?
Yes, are you hearing me?
Yes, I am.
Yeah, so I recommend that masks should be worn by all persons when entering an establishment. As a matter of fact, I want to go so far to take another step and say, when you leave the house, if you're in the car by yourself, before you exit the car, sanitize your hands properly for 20 seconds and then put on your mask correctly, fit it properly to form the shape of your face. To fit the shape of your face and leave. Don't even take your mask, leave it in your pocket or in your purse and put it on outside of the establishment. When you leave the car, it should be on and you should wear it in the grocery, etc. And then when you get home, then you can take it off correctly. That is. Sanitize your hands after you remove it. Don't touch the front of the mask.
All right. Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Charles. I see Douglas has also gone ahead and he's posted some links where you can access stats on internet usage on Trinidad and Tobago, in Trinidad and Tobago. So you can feel free to access those. I also have some questions that were emailed. I think they're specifically bank related. So let me share one or two of those questions that were emailed in, and they also sent answers as well. So one of the first questions I saw being emailed, which is very much bank specific, is are there any local banks which facilitate e-commerce in our country? And if so, how does this work and what is the pricing? The response was also sent. It said, yes, Scotiabank, in fact, is one of the banks that can facilitate. For those interested parties, Scotiabank will call them and share pricing. And this is how it works for Scotiabank. And I suspect it's pretty much the same with other banks as well. Scotiabank works with you and your internet service provider to link your website or into the internet gateway. E-commerce transactions are uniquely identified for easy distinction from your regular business transactions, and they're authenticated and processed securely. Visa and MasterCard transactions are further validated by 3D Secure and protected from potential online fraudulent activity. Settlements are made directly into your account, your Scotiabank account in this case. But as I said, I pretty much suspect it's the same sort of general practice with all the banks. Let me take one more bank question that was emailed to us and the answer before I get back to the questions on the chat. One says here, how long does a payment transfer take to register in my account, both online and e-commerce? Banking provides you with 24/7 access bills, transfer funds. This sounds like an advertisement. Transfer funds between accounts and to persons at other banks. Download statements, view account balances, and receive alerts on the activity on your account. Scotiabank's payments and transfers to other Scotia accounts are immediate. So there's the answer right there. The transfers show up immediately. Payments to other banks are within the same day or the following day, and that depends on the processing cutoff times. Let me skim through the chats again. I'm seeing here Mr. Ames. This is from Michelle Lauchitang. I hope I pronounced that properly, Mr. Ames. Excellent presentation. Is it best to upgrade your existing website to incorporate e-commerce facility or simply produce a new e-commerce site? Douglas?
Yeah, thanks. Michelle, it depends on the state of your website. The first thing we always do, or developers should do, is try to salvage your existing website and mobile app because it will be cheaper or less expensive for you to do so. And over the last 4 to 8 weeks, I'd say about 70% of our business, I'm not sure about other developers, have been doing exactly that, trying to upgrade and salvage what you currently have and make it e-commerce ready without putting you through on any unnecessary expenditure, but also saving you time, because the whole point of this exercise is to get up and running as quickly as possible to ensure that you have some degree of business continuity.
All right. Seeing a question here from Dwight Nelson. This one's for Dr. Charles. What is your recommendation for establishments wanting you to have masks on and to wash hands before entering, yet staff and security are not wearing masks?
All right.
Dr. Charles.
I think that's more of a policy issue, and that's why I stated in the presentation, businesses must ensure that their staff first have on the mask, first use proper PPE and use it all the time, so that customers will be encouraged to do the right thing. So this is something that they have to enforce within house first before they even let customers do it. But as a consumer, remember, when you wear a mask, right, you're actually protecting somebody from getting infected. So it is even more important that the business owners ensure that their staff are wearing a mask to protect you if you are protecting them by wearing a mask also.
Thank you, Dr. Charles. I'm seeing Angel has a hand up. Angel, this is your opportunity to take the floor and ask a question. Angel?
Hi, this is for Ramon. Based on the feedback from potential changing consumption habits, is there any indication of what shoppers in Trinidad are looking like beyond value that is attractive for them in terms of promotional activities, tacticals for shopping behaviors to, so manufacturers can and retailers together can really drive value for them and keep maintaining same level of consumption, not as pre-COVID, but something close to in that new reality that is coming. If there is an indication we can read between the documents and the insight that you generated, that will be my question.
I think that's a question for Ramon.
Yes, it is.
If you may be able to take that.
Oh, Angel, sorry, my mic was muted. What I would say, the simple answer to that question is that in this COVID environment, we have to look at synergies. And the example I made with the doubles, for example, is that the doubles man traditionally was a face-to-face one-on-one service. And if you're familiar with what transpired in the last 2 weeks with other channels being explored, I think that is the way for manufacturing has to now go down channel to be able to understand how to diversify and how to bring stuff up market. So what has to happen is we have to explore synergies of channels in terms of we have to develop stronger channel relationships. No longer the traditional channels that I'm familiar with as a business owner should be my only port of call. I now have to look at how do I go downstream and upstream simultaneously to maximize profit in this environment. So for example, the doubles man on the corner at the junction, but I could now be in a retail channel at Price Mart, for example. I could now be at Massey stores. I could now be at True Value. So one of the things is that manufacturers, it's really a partnership. You have to look at synergies where if we bundle our strengths together, if we are able to synergize and able to offer complementary services, I think this is what this new environment calls for. It's no longer doing business on your own. It's called strategic partnerships. Does that answer your question, Angel?
Angel?
Yes, Ramon. Because my concern and the way we do business in Trinidad is helping retailers and consumers together to drive growth. And in this new context, we brought some experiences. For example, I'm now located in Mexico.
Right.
We are seeing that digital acceptance and the fear of putting your cart in a website. And as you mentioned, people from not traditional digital adoption ages, like old guys, are now in Zoom and now in all those new platforms. So that is dramatically changing the adoption of e-commerce and changing delivery services, speeding up and all that. So all of that has changed value perception.
Yeah,
and the context is critical. Yeah,
you made a very good point about video conferencing, for example. People said, and there's a slang going around, Zoomers are boomers. And why I found that funny is that the baby boomers could be the next wave of commerce. Simply because the commercial activity tends to fixate on that 18 to 35, 18 to 40 year old. But post-COVID now, hold on, an older demographic is now in the mix now, doing some of the things and mimicking some of the behavior of the millennials, of the Gen Zs and younger. So it's not foreign to have an old aunt on TikTok doing dances now with her grandkids and being a strong brand proponent for that particular platform. So we have to really, from a digital perspective, you really have to revisit how you engage each of the different generational cohorts now, because it's not the same playbook that we're playing from anymore.
Thank you, Ramon. I want trying to get all of these questions in quickly. Ramon, I think this might be one for you. Gabriel Williams is asking, where should businesses spend their advertising dollars with everyone being encouraged to stay inside with the limited restrictions? How should businesses advertise? We're just repeating, but it's the same thing. Exactly where should they spend their advertising dollars? So this sounds like a market research question.
Yeah, well, what I would say is the easy answer for that, there's no easy answer for that. As a matter of fact, we're in the process of putting together a media and digital habit study that will inform it. Now, the last media survey, if I'm not mistaken, was conducted in somewhere in 2014, and a new one hasn't been commissioned just yet. So, based on some of the data that Douglas would have presented in terms of the top performing social media platforms, there are some other agencies, for example, that media monitoring and tracking advertising spend is part of their core business. combined with some of the insights that we'll do from our digital habits and media study, I think we'll give a good, we'll give an easier answer for that question. There's a whole myth about traditional media dying, but obviously some elements of traditional media are still doing better than others. So for example, pre-COVID, radio was still very robust. At least some of the frequencies were quite robust, and newspaper print was dying. In the post-COVID environment, I suspect a lot of that will still maintain, and persons will be traversing to the digital platform. So a lot of what Douglas spoke about, for example, you saw the top 10 metrics there for the most used social media platforms. That's a good starting point, I would say. Until more data comes together where you can look at data from this source, that source, and another source, I'll use the word triangulate to kind of understand, okay, I could pick these particular strategies. What I would recommend is trying to integrate your strategies. So a bit of traditional, a bit of digital. Obviously, we do have bottomless pits for pockets, so that it's easier said than done. But what I would say is that the future is really in digital. The future is really navigating towards those social media pages. How you play between them is a bigger conversation we'll have when we have more data. And yet again, it depends on the demographic that you're seeking to attract and who the consumers that you're seeking to come into your house.
All right. There was a question here from Carla. I think you wanted to ask something. Carla Mendez Ambris. Are you there, Carla? Hello, Carla.
This is Carla husband here.
Okay. Sorry.
Sorry about that. That is no problem. That is no problem. What I want to find out is how long from now can we look back and say there was once something named COVID and where business will be back, because we have a business and we are totally shut down, right? We are trying our best to operate online and whatnot, right? But how long do you think that this will last and before we get back to at least 90, 95, 100% normalcy, right? Where we can look back and say there was once something named COVID and life back as normal again.
Well, the easy answer for that, is it Kenroy?
Yes, Kenroy.
Yeah, the easy answer for that, based on the survey that we did, is that 37% of the individuals who we surveyed said that life will never be normal again. And next 33% said 1 year. Let me answer a question for you in 2 to 3 months' time when we really have a full appreciation of what lifting the restrictions look like, what is new normal, and how we settle into this new normal. So it's really like week one or a few days into the new normal. So even I am having difficulties kind of understanding some of the challenges that we're facing. So it really has to flesh out. As we go to different phases across the structured reopening, we'll have a better picture of what to expect and how are some of the brands navigating, how people are feeling at the levels of comfort. Just the initial interactions you're seeing across the media, for example, people taking off masks and walking all over the place like it's business as usual, lest we have a second wave of COVID, we could be in for a big one. So it really is a fluid environment to answer that in a simple way. Perhaps as we track over a particular period of time, we'll be able to pick up and really have some hard numbers that could kind of give us some sort of guide to that.
Yeah, if I may add to that, you know, I can't remember the name, but if I may add to that, even in places, other places where they're starting to ease off on the restrictions, seeing a resurgence of the virus. So I know, for example, in Germany, for the city, the Chinese city, right now they're getting ready to test all 11 million citizens because of fears of, you know, a reemergence. They're seeing signs of a reemergence. So I suppose, as Ramon, that just alludes to what Ramon is attesting to, that, you know, it is pretty fluid and perhaps even difficult at this time. I think it was Douglas who said earlier that perhaps it might make sense to plan for the short and the medium term as opposed to with the eye on the long term, but try to structure your planning around the short and the medium term. Anyway, I saw a question here in the chat from him, Raji Singh. But I think Dr. Charles would have mentioned it, but let me just read the question again. She says she's reading about workers, especially who wear masks for 8 hours, may be susceptible to various medical conditions, and she wants to know if this is correct. I think Dr. Charles would have asked, would have answered that, but I still want you to give a very concise answer to this question. Please, Dr. Charles.
Okay. In answering that question, there is no proven research to that. However, what I can say is for persons who have emphysema or they have breathing difficulty or they are asthmatics, they really should not be using the N95s. And we want to reserve the N95s for the medical practitioners anyway. These are N95s. And when you put it on, it's going to fit very tight on your face. So what will happen is either you are uncomfortable and it will mark your face, or you will take it off and you won't protect yourself. So it's best to use the cloth mask or these masks that are comfortable, adjustable, and very soft inside. They have a filter. So that way that you, even if you have breathing issues or your medical issues, you won't be affected. And also I would like to address the question where they ask, when would life return to normal? I think this is the new normal for now. There is no definitive way, not long-term, medium-term, short-term, unless until we have a vaccine. And the vaccine has been, and we have access to it because we can get a vaccine and then first world countries have it, or countries that have invested into the vaccine will have first use. So until we have a vaccine, there's no return to the old days. What we have to do is to learn to cope and to adjust our businesses to what is now happening.
Thank you, Dr. Charles. Once again, if you have any questions, you can feel free to raise your hand. I'm seeing somebody wanted to ask a question. This is Anna, I think. Am I correct?
Yes. Good night. You know, Mr. Ames was talking about e-commerce and things like that. And my son is a senior design engineer in the United States. And what he has said is that there has been a surge of demand by companies, different types of companies, for chips and for different MMW chips, and so in order to transition into all this e-commerce and this internet and so. And it's only about 2 months and you're seeing everything just changing. I want to ask Mr. Ames, in the long term, all right, for now we're doing this. We have this platform, we plan to sell our products and so. In the long term, what impact do you see it having on the world? It's only a matter of time where it will trickle down from the US into other countries. What impact do you see in the long term for this? Because obviously it's not going to change now, and this really is a new normal.
Hi, Anna. So I would say that it has already changed. Mm-hmm. Everything is now being done online. And I don't know if we have any representatives, Maria, of the Bankers Association on the call, but I saw an article, and it was verified by my banker, that in Trinidad and Tobago, before the end of the year, all of the commercial banks would be replacing everyone's Lynx cards with what is known as a Lynx Visa debit card. And the banks have agreed to open up Lynx Visa debit cards to all local e-merchant companies that want to transact business in TT dollars. So COVID-19 forced everyone to pay bills online, forced everyone to figure out online banking, forced everyone to set up websites and apps to accept orders and provide services online. But payment, the issue of payments has always been the problem, because there are only about 15% of credit card holders in Trinidad and Tobago. So everyone used to say, well, what about the other 80 or 85% in Trinidad, Douglas? They don't have credit cards. How will they buy online from me? But with the introduction of the Lynx Visa debit card, anybody under the sun that has a debit card, that has a Lynx bank card, the new one, will now be able to purchase and transact in TT dollars only, because of foreign exchange restrictions, on local e-commerce websites. doesn't matter your socioeconomic background, whether you are credit worthy or not, you will, everybody will now be empowered to go online and purchase. I would ask the Bankers Association why they didn't do that 4 years ago, but I'm not a banker. But the point is that it's already here. And with the introduction of that, you're going to see everybody under the sun is now going to go online, because that has been the number one hindrance to going online with your business, is the lack of payment options available in Trinidad and Tobago. I hope that answered your question.
Yes, it did.
Thank you, Douglas. Douglas, while you're there, maybe you can take this other question. It's from just now. Right. Douglas, there's a question from Valerie Kelsick. She wants to know, what are your predictions of pricing strategies of businesses, considering reduced propensity to spend, adoption of new technologies, etc.?
Well, we have a number of clients that will tell you their strategy has been to slash prices. Right now, everybody is trying to give you a deal. Some are trying to add value, but everybody is giving deals. Even we are giving deals. So everybody is already slashing their prices, and you'd find that the marketplace is going to become much more competitive. And I think in every sector. And because everyone is aware of the economic conditions, I think you find most businesses will be very partial to doing deals with you. So that in my view is already happening and will continue to happen, I suspect, for the rest of the year. I'm not an economist, but I did attend a few sessions recently with Dr. Dukaran and a few others online, and I saw that, pricing is one that will happen over the next, is something that will continue to be competitive over the next 12 to 18 months. Inflation, on the other hand, is another matter, but these businesses will be a lot more competitive with their pricing, and their strategy will be a value offered one, and we're already seeing it every day. And for those of you who, the airline businesses in particular, I got a question privately about, Douglas, you represent Caribbean Airlines and their digital media. Do you think that they will offer me great deals to Miami? I suspect they will when the borders reopen, because everybody will want to do a deal. So everything is going to be very competitively priced, or is already on the path. But of course, Ramon, we need to do a survey about that. But that seems to be the general sentiment in speaking with my clients.
Thank you very much, Douglas. I would have alluded earlier that the Bankers Association, they emailed in some questions and answers. There were three or four. I actually went through two. But I'm seeing here Maria said that those responses will be emailed, those questions and responses will be emailed to all of you, all attendees. So you can also let her know if you have any additional questions. So with Maria's permission, I will take a couple more questions. I'm not seeing any more in the chat, but I'll just open the floor for about one or two more questions. Any other questions anybody like to ask? Well, I'm seeing one
hi,
here.
Can I ask a question?
Of course, Colleen, go ahead.
Hi, how are you doing, Douglas? Hi, I remember sitting in on a presentation you did several years ago. So it's great to see that you're back, you're in this community. My question is, I am pretty computer savvy, I think I'm okay. But I'm just wondering how you are dealing with, as you said, over the past 6 to 8 weeks, people who have just used the computer for getting onto Facebook, and so now have to transition their businesses to all these, e-commerce things. And so how does one go from 0 to 100 to be able to have all these systems in place? I'm just wondering how you all have been dealing with that, with so many people coming at you, I imagine, and having some of them having to go from 0 to 100 to transition to this new way of operating through e-commerce, being even on this Zoom call. As you know, we would have been sitting down in the UE in all now having this chat, so how has it been? How have you in the industry? What have you heard?
From what I understand from speaking to some of our colleagues in the industry, including our own experience, it's been very challenging to keep up to be quite honest. I actually had a promotion to try and help businesses where I promised them that I would deliver an e-commerce solution for them in 72 hours. Within a week, I had to pull the ad because I just couldn't keep up. We have different clients or different prospective clients at different stages of the business, Colleen, different stages in their life, Colleen, as you mentioned. Zero to 100 is a lot harder for us to deal with. It really depends on the nature of your business and whether you have the resources. Some of the larger companies, quite frankly, that have the money can afford to could ramp up very quickly, because what we can do is we can divvy it up to different providers and collaborate with different service providers for everyone to do their part and get you from a zero to 100 in a week or two. But to be quite honest, our focus has been on trying to help those businesses that already have some sort of digital media presence, whether a website, app, or even Facebook, and to try and get them up and running within the quickest possible time. What's very interesting, Colleen, is that some people aren't too time sensitive, in that the people who need to go from zero to 100, a lot of them, I don't have my stats in front of me, but I did a spreadsheet. Ramon would be very impressed, I think, where I monitored all of this. And there was a large percentage that said, I don't want to rush this because I know it's a big investment. I will wait for 6 to 8 weeks or 3 months to get it done. I want to do it right. But I know this is the new normal. So I suspect in 6 months' time and in a year's time, I'm going to need this. And quite frankly, if COVID-19 is not resolved, we don't find a vaccine or there's a relapse, etc., then I will need to have this structure in place. And I never, ever again want to get caught with my pants down. So those are the kind of responses we've gotten. But as I said, it has been very hectic. And to be quite blunt with you, Colleen, we can't help everybody. I even got a call from a competitor telling me, please stop referring people to him. He is swamped as well. But we have been trying our best to focus on those that we can help immediately. And for those who can't, some of them are prepared to wait. And for others, I've even been referring some people to GoDaddy.com that have a small web division to see if they can help get them online. But the problem is they don't integrate with local banks here, so they end up having to come back to us to do the local integration. But sorry, I'm going off on a tangent. I hope that answered your question, Colleen, and I hope when you last saw me, you would have realized I had a lot more hair back then, so I have changed.
Yes, and just as a follow-up quickly, if you don't mind, Desmond, I have actually been assisting a client who's been in bringing a system up online, and it's been like, you know, 2 o'clock in the morning, you know, we are getting stuff up. So with businesses that are coming online now, where you are customer, okay, let's say by 5, you have finished servicing your customers. How do you put systems in place when invoices are coming in at 3 in the morning and Sunday evening when you're having lunch or that kind of thing, and you would like, I believe, to be able to respond to your clients? How does that work?
Yeah, it depends on the nature of your business, but I would tell you to automate as much as possible. If they're coming to you via email, you can have auto replies set up with links to payment gateways where they can access the invoice online, as well as be able to pay it online. In the case of Facebook and some of the social media platforms, there's artificial intelligence in the form of chatbots, for which you can have frequently asked questions and answers pre-programmed in the chatbot, and they are getting better and better every day, where the chatbots are actually learning customers' responses and understanding their behavior and automatically spitting out replies that are most appropriate. So that would help you a great deal. And if you wish, Colleen, I can message you my contact information. You can give me a call in the morning and I can give you someone. You could tell me more about what the business is, and I could happily give you some suggestions as to how you might automate more.
All right, I think we have time for one more question, and it's interesting you should mention chatbots, Douglas, because I have another question. It's not sure if it's a question or a comment, but it's from Anna, and I guess perhaps you or Ramon, resulting in huge losses as AI is set to take over on a large scale.
Let me go first, Ramon, and then you could answer. I have been told by a lot of clients, large and small, unfortunately, that they do need to reduce staff numbers. And one of the reasons they're coming to us is to try and automate as much as possible so they can reduce their overhead costs, which unfortunately would involve people. So that is a reality. And I'd say probably 3 out of every 5 clients are asking me that question. How do we automate so that if I do a retrenchment exercise, I'm not left hanging? It's very unfortunate, but it is a reality of the situation. But that is just our experience dealing with existing and prospective clients. I don't know if Ramon has any data on it. I know Central Bank and Common Bay have been publishing some stuff, but I don't know, Ramon.
Yeah, I don't have any specific data on that. But what I would say is that right now we are in the experience economy. And it's an article I read some time ago, and it spoke about people being into experiences alongside looking for the great deals and value. And yes, I think it's no surprise, no secret that yes, we will have huge job losses. The role of AI is, I think the jury is still out with that, simply because when we have tried AI at Lucent Research, for example, and administering questionnaires and administering surveys, people felt it, as the name says, quite artificial. Persons found it quite stoic and very, very regimented, and didn't leave room for expression, leave room to get to probe and get some more data. So it's specific to the industry that you're working in, I would say. It's specific to the environment. So some environments, some call centers are going the route of AI now. But what I would say is that, yes, there will be some job loss, but the job loss and favoring AI, I think the verdict is still out there. Give me 2 or 3 months, let me put out some surveys out there, and I could get some feedback on that for you. But at this point in time, it's very indecisive.
Thank you very much. Maybe at some point in time, the chamber could put on a meeting about, you know, opportunities in a new AI world. I know perhaps there's something to consider at some point. I just while we're on that and while we're getting ready to close up, I just want to remind everybody that next week, Thursday, there'll be another one of these wonderful ideas. I like to call them idea sharing initiatives, the title of which will be Business Leadership in the New Normal. And the facilitator, at least one of them, would be Maxine Atong, who is the president of the Human Resource Management Association of Trinidad and Tobago. She's also a very well-known business consultant. So next week, Thursday, 8 p.m., that's right, you can look out for that. Business Leadership in the New Normal. So with, I'm looking for a cue from Anna to tell me whether I should start to close off or not, but I'm not seeing anything, so. So let me just say this. So ladies and gentlemen, if there are no more questions or comments,
can I ask one more question?
With the blessings of the organizers, I would, of course.
Sorry for ending the closing off session, closing off
speech. That's all right.
Yes. An idea that ran through my mind is the bartering system. Let's go back to the ancient days of bartering, right? Exchange of goods. Of goods for services and stuff like that is what it is? Right. Seeing that businesses closing down, people losing the job and so on, I am a professional photographer and there's hardly any need for my service right now, right? So I was thinking, do you think that this service can come back where I can go and do a job for a company and they pay me with grocery instead, or something of that sort, in exchange, right? Do you think that the exchange can come back like how it used to be in the ancient days?
I mean, I can take a crack at that. Well, I would imagine that is a possibility. It depends on an individual arrangement. I guess that if that was something that would satisfy your particular household, your particular income stream, I see no reason why that can happen. Well, it can happen en masse. I would be very surprised if we go back to bartering, simply because, I mean, that's as ancient a system of trade as we know, especially when you're talking the language of AI and mobile pay, and we have all these new technologies in terms of how we access and how we make payments. I don't foresee that being something that'll be on a macro level. I'll probably be down to the micro level for smaller businesses, possibly like yourselves. But I don't think that's realistic and sustainable.
All right, thank you. Yeah, thank you, John. Thank you, sir. So ladies and gentlemen, saying if there are no more questions or comments, and with the blessings of the organizers, I'd like to thank the presidents of the various hosts and Rajiv Dipti, our panelists who enlightened us on various issues, challenges, and possibilities that are likely to confront us in the new post-COVID-19, new normal era. And to you, ladies and gentlemen, for attending and taking an interactive role in today's proceedings through your putting in questions, your salient comments, and your sharing of your views and ideas. So, good night, everyone. Blessings to you and your families. Keep safe, and please look out for other such initiatives put on by the Greater Tunapuna Chamber of Industry and Commerce. And as I said, the next one is next Thursday. So look out for the information. Good night, everyone.